It's Cinnamon Cooney, your Art Sherpa, back for Sunset Cowboy, the surprise art lesson to reward us for beginning our art quest. Because I always feel like at the beginning of the journey, you need a little reward for just having the courage of taking the first step. This is a fantastic, fun painting. I'm going to show you the picture again that we're going to be doing. We're going to be getting this done fairly quick. I'm going to guide you through every step of this acrylic painting. So it's a really fun process. For all of you guys that are here in the live, you kind of know all that, but if you're first time here, you're going to have so much fun painting with us and chatting with us and being with us, because this is by far the funnest community on YouTube. I really think that's true. And I've been going and watching some of those other live events. On my mic is my husband, John.
Hey, everybody.
He controls the cameras, which, you know what, honey? You're going to have to come fix the up close when we do some up close, because it's wonky over here.
I'm over there, right?
And palette, are we good? Surprise lessons come. We have four cameras, and John controls all of those and reads the comments. So if you guys have questions or statements, John's the one who's doing that. And also, he's in charge of the other birthday wish we have today.
Oh,
we have
from
a
Joanne.
Birthday shout out.
For Joanne.
Joanne, happy birthday.
That's right. Happy birthday.
Happy artful, creative, awesome birthday. So we've had a couple birthdays today, which is really cool. Painting today on a 16 by 20 canvas. I like to watch the chats before I get on just to see if there's anything pertinent. And the question that really popped up at me is, do you need to gesso the canvas if it says pre-gessoed? You don't need to, but you may want to. If you purchased, like I did, a very economic 5-pack of canvases for Michael, sometimes those won't take the paint very nicely, and a little coat of gesso will work that out. But if you got a beautiful Frederick's canvas or the Edge canvas, you might not need to do anything to it all, because they do a beautiful job of preparing those surfaces. So hopefully that answers that question, and John's working on the camera. Right now we call him Stunt Hands, because sometimes we only see his hands, but they're fabulous stunt hands and we like them. Today we're painting acrylic paint. I'm painting heavy bodied paint. But you could do this in, especially sunsets and these silhouette paintings, you can do these in a soft-bodied paint and a craft paint. So just paint along with whatever you have today. I've got water. We use water to thin our paints because, you know, all acrylic paint is designed to be thinned up to 30% by water. You can always check the paint's tolerances on the website. Even though, like, if we were doing fine art, we might do, you know, some type of airbrush medium or something like that. We're going to do water today because it's just fine. It's just fine. I've got my Simply Simmons brush that I stole from my mother.
Yep.
If you're first time here, you're like, wait, you steal brushes from your mother? Yeah, when they're this good and she leaves them behind. This is a 1-inch bright. If you caught my Periscope, you saw my little brush rant up there at Michael's about why these are not all the same sizes. So even though this says a 10 on it, and I can tell you it's Simply Simmons, this will only help you buy this exact brush online. It won't help you find another bright from another brand. You'd think it would, but it won't, because you got to see them and touch them. Are you guys ready to do this painting? Are they ready?
They're ready.
We need wishes. Has anybody got any wishes?
Oh my gosh, there's so, yeah, we have lots of wishes. There's been lots of wishes.
I need to put some wishes on this canvas so I can get my creative on.
We have always get a lot of wishes for good inner tube signal, but we've been having pretty good inner tube signal.
Keep up the wishes for the good inner tubes. Let's have Heart Party signal just be good now and forever. I'm going to even write that now and forevers.
I'm going to get
no matter where we are.
I'm going to go for the low-hanging fruit, and okay. Everyone's going to wish for easy pear paintings.
All right. Easy pear paintings. Okay.
Let's see here. And we have, of course, a couple wishes for our very happy birthdays.
Yeah.
For Kim and Joanne.
Kim and Joanne, happy birthday.
And we have a couple wishes for moms who are recovering in hospitals.
All right. Yes.
So we got two, I think I saw two moms that are looking for
easy recovery. And I wish that they get the good nurses. That's a personal wish.
Good, yes, good nurses.
Yeah, the good ones. You know.
Lots of wishes for success.
The perfect one for them, I wish that.
We have a lot of quest success wishes there.
Oh, yes. Well.
And Sarah is wishing for a less busy day in the ER.
Oh, Sarah. Yeah. You know what? Given what that would mean, I hope you have a quiet, boring day in the ER.
And here's a wish for Elizabeth, who needs a transplant. Whatever that is, we wish you the best for that.
Well, Sarah, unless you see Elizabeth.
Yes. And then definitely hook Elizabeth up.
And then hopefully that's the only excitement that you have in the ER. I really look forward to when they're able to print that, aren't you?
Mm-hmm.
And that isn't such a hard journey for people, because it's a terrible journey right now to get a transplant.
Whoa,
and so I wish that they get better at printing organs.
Yes. I think that's really a good one. And she's looking for a kidney, I think. As I scroll down here, there's a lot more people.
I just feel like there should be a breakthrough in printing organs this year. I would love that.
Mm-hmm. We're going to wish to Jane, Jane's son, so he keeps his job, and happy birthday, too.
Job and happy birthday. Well, happy birthday would be the job.
I think we're going to wish for a lot of kidney health, because I see some people have some kidney stones that are coming up and some kidney pain. So let's wish for some good kidney health.
Kidney.
For those of you cowboys who've ridden on horseback, this is a good wish on a cowboy painting.
Yes.
Wish for kidney health.
Right. I'm going to wish for lots of inspiration for my coloring book, and then we get it to market and that it does really good.
Yes. Wish for success on our coloring book. That would be great.
I'm really liking working on that.
And more tropical weather.
Yeah. And wish for us more tropical weather.
Yeah. It's cold in Texas right now.
Well, not compared to the rest of the world.
Unseasonably cold for Texas.
You're very incapable of handling any real cold. It's like chilly. John doesn't handle any actual weather. He's like those like really difficult to care for fish that you have to keep the temperature like within 5 degrees in aquarium.
That's me. But I want to say thanks for everyone who's putting up all of the wishes. Thank you so much. And for all those we can't get to, we really appreciate all of the other Sherpettes and our community to put those on your canvas to help carry those good wishes forward for us all.
Yeah, all you lightkeepers. And remember that you can put them on your canvases at home. If you see another wish, one that really touched you that we somehow missed or just spoke to, even if we got it, you can put that into your canvas. You can wish for big things. You can wish for silly things.
Mm-hmm.
Wishes are just like that. They're free and wonderful. I'm going to get my brush wet.
Oh, okay.
Are you ready for that?
I'm ready for it.
I'm going to. Am I good on my angle here?
I think so.
I think I need some help with this up close cam.
Okay.
While I'm getting my brush wet.
All right. What's wrong with the up close camera?
I'm going to start painting and then you'll see when you switch. It's just at a crazy angle.
Oh, you gotta just zoom it in.
It's just at a crazy.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Yeah, it's just at a really crazy angle. So you could just fix that, and then I'll get started. Because we really like the up close cam, because sometimes that helps you guys really, really see what's happening in a painting when we can zoom in and you can see the brush strokes and the texture and how things are blending. While John's adjusting the up close cam, if this is your very first painting, the things that you're going to want to think about is how the brush works and loads paint, how the paint flows off onto the canvas, and how much of the canvas is being covered up. If you find you're seeing a lot of canvas showing through, it's probably just that you don't have enough fluid in your paint. And if it looks like a drippy watercolor, you might have too much. All right, so when I get my brush wet, I just moisten the bristles. I tap it off. Okay, we're just making sure we get it all covered. Because we like to be a certain way. John's going to come over to the palette, and I'm going to show you what colors I have out today. So really
simple.
What
colors do you have?
It's like primaries in a purple.
Really?
So dioxazine purple, phthalo blue, titanium white, cadmium yellow medium, and cad red medium. If you buy hue, you can save some money. All right. And I keep getting... That's funny how many times I've wet that brush.
Wow.
So I'm pulling this out, and I want it kind of fluid, but not runny, and I'm going to add a little blue to this, all right? And maybe just a scotch of white, just to pick it up, the color of it. I'm going to come up at the top, and I'm going to go across my canvas with this. I really like painting sunsets.
Do you?
Mm-hmm. Now, if you look in the description, there's a link to the photograph I was first inspired by Saif Patel from Paint My Photo. As you guys know, I'm a huge fan of the Paint My Photo website. I think it's a tremendous resource for artists. I just grabbed a little bit of white And what I'm trying to do, and if you can see this on the up-close cam, is I'm trying to make sure that I'm covering all of the white canvas underneath. There's a thing that can happen where you get little pockets of white showing, and you wanna beat those back, right? Now I'm gonna come over and I'm gonna add a little red to my purple as I'm going down. Little red to my purple. A little white if I need to. I'm gonna blend these two areas together where I need to. I'm making horizontal brush strokes. I'm not going crisscross. That would be something that might mess up the look of my painting. And if I were a new painting, I might not know that. And that's just something, you know, to be aware of, pay attention to. We call it brush directionality. What direction is my brush stroke going?
So there's some votes on some new camera angles.
What are the new camera angle votes? And we could definitely experiment with those maybe by the next one.
So they're thinking that they like the idea of a left-hand side close-up camera.
Oh, because, I love that idea.
You know, your right hand sometimes...
I think we can do a fifth camera, can't we?
Yeah, I think we can add another one on the other side. But when we were experimenting with it earlier, we had trouble with the camera on that side only seeing... It was really useful, but only if you had a lot of control over it. Like, because you had to always adjust its...
Yeah.
Where it's on the right-hand side, it was more usable more often. So that's why we put it over there on the right.
Like sorry, that. But you've got that there. And you can see what I'm talking about, that white pitting. That's what you're trying to cover up. Now, I'm going to rinse out my brush really well. And if you're having trouble rinsing it out, you can even switch to another brush. Right?
Yep.
And I'm going to pull away from where I had the purple a little of my red and pull it into my orange. And I will gray it with a small amount of purple. Not too much, because you don't want to gray it too much. And I'm going to blend between the orange and the purple. Now, because these are contrasting colors, the purple will gray the orange a little bit. But you want that for the blending. You see that blending there, John?
Yeah, I do.
Right? Rinse it. And then you're just pulling out a little of the yellow, a little of the red. And this is so fun to do. Maybe a little more red into this. I want this to be sort of hotter than what it is. I'm wasting my brush. And it is okay for as we go down for this to be a little bit streaky. Because that will help us tell our cloud story. And it's okay that if you're painting with your friends, your family, not everybody's sunset's going to look the same. But in nature, it generally doesn't paint the same sunset every day anyways. So you should give yourself the same forgiveness that you give nature when nature is painting. I picked up a little more red on that one. And I'm going to be pulling this gradation as I come down. Not too much water. If I get too much, I'll get runny. But enough to pick up my paint. Oh, that's a nice bright red streak. I'm going to blend that in. It's really fun to blend these in. Right? And it's really fun to do sunsets, in my opinion. I'm going to get a little more yellow into this. Maybe even a little white. And hit this next level. Fun stuff. Fun, cool stuff. If you're feeling tension, don't forget to breathe.
Now, this one is going to stay up now. We're going to leave this lesson up.
Yeah, we're going to take the time lapse of this down, but we're going to leave this lesson up, and this lesson is going to replace the time lapse.
We may re-put the time lapse up again later with a different music set to it.
Yeah, we just need a different music set to it. Or maybe I'll do a whole new cowboy sunset that we haven't seen before.
Yeah.
Something exciting. I'm going to add a lot more white to this little section here.
So what do you think about having maybe a hat cam?
I would so love to strap the GoPro to my head, even though that would look super ridiculous. We would get a bunch of comments.
We could make a hat around it. The hat cam. And then I'll have to get like a wireless transmitter. Actually, I didn't even have to do wireless. We just have to tether you. This long tethered cable.
So I picked up a little bit of yellow and added just a little bit of red to it. And I'm working this over here, blending. I haven't put out my black paint yet for a reason, which is that basically...
You don't want to be tempted?
No.
No.
Now I'm going to be a little crazy here as I come back down. I'm going to get back into my red. Crazy. And get some bright orange going here.
You could hide the camera inside a top hat.
I could. I certainly have made some top hats. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Is everyone seeing what I'm doing pretty well? This is a slightly more dramatic sunset. Like the birds on a branch we have coming up. It's a simpler one. You know, and I'm going to let this streak up into here. My brush pressure when I'm streaking lightens up a bit.
Yes.
Right? And then as I'm working into the canvas, it gets a little heavier. That's an important thing to keep track of. What's the brush pressure? Brush pressure.
Is it wet cat pressure?
No. If you were doing this to a wet cat, it would just eat you. It would just end you, and you would deserve it.
This is dirty dog pressure.
This is dirty, itchy dog pressure down
here. Dirty dogs.
Dirty
dogs. Scrub the dirty dogs.
So this is fun. We're just creating a nice bright orange kind of effect here. So we've got some, when we put our clouds in, this is going to be really nice. And I'm taking this all the way down, even though I know I'm going to come back with some black. Because this also seals up my canvas.
Yeah. Gets that nice undercoating.
It does. Just a little bit of this. Seal it up.
So,
some tonality.
Angie says that she only has light and deep in her CAD colors. How does she get to a medium color?
Not worry about it.
Don't sweat it.
Yeah. Which is it, the yellow or the reds? Or is it in both?
I don't know. She didn't specify. Bowl, maybe you can hear in a couple seconds.
The reason I say don't worry about it is that, you know, so the CAD light, right, when you mix it, and this is something we're going to cover in deep in the color mixing thing, you know, it's still going to give you a reliable gradation. And on a painting like this, you know, where there isn't like a set formulation, as long as it's doing these patterns, it's going to be enjoyable. So even if you were like, you know, I might enjoy the deeps because this is a sunset. Enjoy the CAD deeps. But you could get away with it in the lights. Just have fun with it. See how it works out. So I'm going to rinse my brush. Rinse my brush. I put way more white out than I needed. I don't know what I was thinking. You know, I might even pick up a little purple on there. And I'm going to come up here, and on the corner of my brush, and I'm going to take my up-close cam up to this.
No,
I got my bright here loaded. Let me see, show you how it's loaded.
Down. There you go. Now, these videos, they're up for free, right?
Yeah, forever.
Forever.
For as long as there's YouTube, anyway.
And if not, we'll have them on our website or something.
Yeah. I am doing soft. Now, this is wet cat pressure. If you were messing with a wet Bengal tiger, how would you touch that? And I'm painting these wispy sort of clouds.
Very carefully, I think.
Yeah, very lightly. Very lightly I'm pressing.
Like tickling a dragon.
Oh, I like that, tickling a dragon. I'm going to make the cloud flat on the bottom.
So do we have a dragon name?
I'm still letting everyone name the dragon, but we're close. I have some favorites.
Oh, yeah, there were some good ones.
Yeah, and so I'm putting up some wind pressure up here. See how I fluff it up? I like to call this the Jackie Chan.
Ah.
Because Jackie Chan gives you no pattern, so you can't predict what he's doing.
So you just Jackie Chan it up, so there's
I'm
no
Jackie
patterns.
Channing this up. Now, if you wanted to do a mixing white or zinc, you might even get more translucent clouds easier. Tell the story over here a little bit. Look at that, just a little story. I got this paint on here. It's got other little colors sort of mixed into it. Just, you know, I just want to I'm gonna give this a western sky. A little light storyline. And then even down here, it's maybe a little light storyline. I like to tell these little silly stories. That's probably going to be behind the horse. I don't even know I painted that there. And that'll happen. Like, sometimes when you're doing silhouette, you'll have, like, this nice little relaxed idea, and then you're like, that's going to be gone in 2 seconds.
So, what's the difference between mixing white and zinc white?
Mixing white is zinc white and titanium white, and it's still translucent. Zinc white is just zinc white. It's even more translucent.
Hmm, okay. Now, I have a smelly question for you.
I have a smelly answer. Do you see how I danced that cloud right here? I went
ziggity
zig. Nope,
because you don't have the close-up camera on.
Oh, tell me when I don't have the close-up
camera. Well, I was watching you on the other camera.
Okay. you get to watching me, and then you forget. So I'm just dancing this along here, just telling this little cloud story. And some of this might end up behind the horse.
Yep.
And then I have one last little thing to do here, John. I'm going to get a detail brush. This is a brush that comes to a point. This is by Creative Mark. It's a number 12, but like I demonstrated at our Michael's Periscope, that's irrelevant.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm going to wait to put my little son in until we're all done so that I have some leeway on the horse and I'm not moving my horse to accommodate for my son. I'm still going to be using the detail brush, though.
Gotcha.
But I'm going to be putting out Mars black. Wouldn't matter if it were carbon black or bone black or whatever, as long as it's all the same black. Sometimes if you mix a black, you get different finishes. And that isn't fun. I have put out too much white paint. I'm going to have to do another painting after this.
Now, wasn't there a black that turned blue or brown?
Yeah, but that's an oil painting.
Oh,
and
yeah.
We don't really get that color in acrylic. So. Okay. And at the point you're painting your oils there, you sort of know which one that is. But maybe we'll cover it in the quest.
Yeah, you'll have to boom up and over.
I just splashed my face.
Yay, splashing.
Yay!
So here's the stinky question.
Hmm.
Have you ever heard of cleaning your brushes in warmed vinegar?
Yeah. And I've heard of alcohol and I've heard of Murphy's oil soap.
What do you think about that warmed vinegar?
So what I would say is that it's an acid.
Yeah.
And you have to think about what an acid does to the manufacturer of the brush.
So check with your brush manufacturer before you go dipping it in acid.
Yeah, some brushes would be just like come out real clean and be okay. And some brushes would be like... Because they weren't planning on you doing that. They were barely planning on you washing it with Dawn. So that's all I would say about it. Nothing wrong with it. Now, you might want to. I'm gonna sketch it out. And you'll definitely want to sketch out your silhouette. And here's my feelings on silhouettes. They're really easy to do.
Okay.
As soon as we're done painting this, I'm going to shoot this over to Chuck to get a traceable for you guys.
Traceables.
But go online. Print out a silhouette.
Yeah.
Check out the silhouette.
Find yourself a cowboy.
Of our guy, right, that I grabbed the picture from. You know, go ahead and just play with that experience, you know. I'm going to make sure I can see my painting would be the first thing. Make sure I can see my painting really, really clearly. I'm going to gesture in and draw on my horse in chalk and then paint it in with black and then I can dust off the extra chalk.
Okay.
So that's what I'm going to do, and I hopefully am going to have the up-close camera on it.
You were perfect, and you just all nauseated us.
I'm
sorry. All right, there you
go. Cam. So I'm going to get in the gesture of my horse of what I want to have happen here. I always like to draw on the neck, hit the flank in first, create the back, give myself some flanking thought. And I just try to figure out where I feel like my horse is going to be when I'm doing this, you know. And that's kind of what you're doing. The reason why silhouettes are sometimes easier for people to draw is that it takes some of the lines that confuse our brain away. This is an Arab horse. I'm gonna
make sure. The lines confuse my brain.
No. People can often find an easier... So with an Arab, I always like to dish the head. It just makes me happy to do that.
So Lisa was asking, who do you suggest for watercolor tutorials? There's a couple people out there.
Yeah, definitely Lindsay.
Yeah, Lindsay has a ton. She's like 1,200 videos.
Art Food Kitty is suggested by a lot of people.
Yep.
Okay. On Facebook, he's Marty Owens, but I think he's somebody else on YouTube, so I'll put his link in the description.
Yeah.
Because I think he's really good, and he does these really wonderful watercolors. And actually, Lindsay introduced me to him, and I just thought, this guy is bananas cool. So I like to sketch this in. So even I still like to sketch my stuff in, you know. Plan my event, and it's good for me to sketch it in. Because on something that's complicated like this, if I just freehand it in black paint, then I'm really working to paint it out if I'm not loving it. You know what I'm saying? And so I like to bring the little hoof back here. And then I'll definitely want, you know, a little another little leg coming up. And can you guys see the sketching in at all?
Yeah.
All right. So this is when I like to work my horse in. I'm looking at my lines. I bend my knee, come down. The nice thing about the silhouette is that I can peek my little hoof out here. I don't have to worry about what all is happening here. You know, got his little girth coming down. It comes in because he's an Arab. Arabs will have a bigger chest than a quarter horse and some other horses. Because they have large nostrils and very large lungs. Just a weird thing when you're trying to do an Arab. Besides the dish face, you got to remember that large nostril space and a large chest. Just something you might not know.
Oh, here's a good question from Ashley.
Okay, I'm bringing the flank down here.
So this is something that, you know, makes me think of your mom. So she wonders, if you buy a gallery wrap canvas and then didn't paint all the edges all the way around, could you go back in with black paint and paint all the edges to make it match the same color, or maybe some color of the paint that goes with the painting?
Well, if you were just doing it for your home, sure, you can do whatever you want. If you were doing it for exhibit, no.
Oh, yeah?
No. You can't do that for exhibit, but you could do that for your home.
So you'd be better to finish it off going around the corners.
Yeah, if you want to show or take that to a gallery or do anything with it, you're definitely going to want to finish it. Maybe I want to do it. And so I'm just trying to figure out where to balance my leg because I'm going to want to show that these are two separate legs. I'm going to make sure that I don't have some weird kind of crazy proportion going here. I found doing him was an interesting thing. I'm making my little saddle up here, and I'm going to... I did this crazy, like, flick tail.
They're loving the horse.
Are they?
Yeah.
It's fun to do horses. I like doing it. I like doing the cowboy, too, but he's a little journey. I'm going to draw his little gesture in. So I just know his head shouldn't go above the horse's head, so I just try to make sure I've got that in.
Yeah.
You know.
So next time you go onto the brush, make sure you explain that sharp edge of the brush.
The sharp edge of the brush?
Yeah.
Sure.
Kim Sim was asking about that.
So. Happy to explain. Sharp edges of the brush.
Yeah. We've had some Russian visitors who are, you know, coming in and saying hello.
Hi.
And, there's some language barrier, but Google Translate's been doing a pretty good job. Bonnie's on there.
I am
swinging the bat at that.
I am really happy with Google Translate, especially in that area for the fact that, you know, we're painting globally together. We're going to, for our Russian visitors, we're going to get real drilled down. Don't worry.
Yeah, and thank you guys for joining us. I mean, we've got like 175 people out here painting along with us right now, so it's just, you know, thanks, guys.
So I'm going to get defined on his face when I get in the black paint because the chalk isn't really ideal for that, you know. And so, you know, we've got this little body here that I'm showing. And then there's the hand for the reins, which are up high because... he's dealing with a horse that's rearing on him. And so now I can put that in black paint because I have kind of a feeling about... Oh, and I have a bush I want to tell a story about. Where's this bush story I'm telling? So this is how I did this. I'm trying to kind of update it but not deviate. I'm going to start working on a...
What do you got? Is that a sharp?
You got to just tell me to go down. This
is bright?
A bright.
It's a bright.
Sharp. This is... about this wide. Okay, which one are you doing?
That
you
one?
Stop it, John. You are a problem. You are a problem and need to be dealt with. I'm going to pull my black paint. I'm loading it on just the edge of my brush here. Like this. And now proof is in the pudding because we're gonna solidify these lines with these black lines. Right.
So what is your sippy sippy?
Water.
Water.
Yeah. When today is, well, it's early. It would be so weird if it wasn't for me, wouldn't it? Just working this jawline.
We are just painting.
Trying to deal with the lower muzzle. I like doing this, just sketching this in. I can come in with a detail brush and think about this some more. I just want to get this fleshed in a sense of this cowboy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's going to be all kinds of mean nonsense and everything happening here. And I'll be switching from this detail round. Detail round.
Yeah. So
to my bright.
Yeah, could you use like a dark pastel on this if you didn't want to do the silhouette in acrylic?
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Like, could you do this in pastels? Yes.
Do the silhouette part in charcoal.
On an acrylic painting. Not without a ground to allow for that.
So you'd have to put some ground on it?
If you're just trying to sketch it in, you're golden. If you're trying to make a permanent piece, no, that would not work without ground.
Okay, so black charcoal wouldn't stick.
To the acrylic paint, not in any way. And not even with the fixative and stuff. It would be problematic. You do need a ground. There is an absorbent ground for pastels by Golden.
Yeah.
And they make for that very purpose.
Interesting.
Fixes all those problems. Now I am going to need two coats on my black to get my good silhouette effect.
Yeah.
That is going to happen. And then I'm going to want to clean up my pastels when everything is dry, my chalk here, which I can do when everything is dry. And a lot of it will clean up in the painting process. I don't need this so much for the tree, but for a complicated shape like the horse, I like to sketch it in.
Now, Sarah would like to know if brights
Hi, Sarah.
And flat brushes are the same.
Brights and flats. Okay, so the reason they give them different names is they actually do a slightly different job.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and if you like were to say even Google like the difference between a bright and a flat, they're very, very, very similar. And it's like about it's the same thing as like a wash sometimes.
Ah, so the
and it's
stiffness
about the
of
length
the brush.
Of the, it's the length of the bristles and how sharp they are. Uh-huh. And that's sometimes I've seen companies name them willy-nilly, sort of like they size them willy-nilly.
Where you'll take a stippling brush, then call it a deerfoot stippler.
Well, that actually looks like a deerfoot. That's the correct naming of it.
I know, but okay. It's still kind of crazy.
Just painting in this little bent hoof here. So you've got the little balls on the joints.
Angled shaders.
Angled shaders. I love angled shaders.
Unangled shaders.
Yeah. It's just, you know.
Fan brushes.
Ugh, fan brushes.
I like the silicone brushes.
The ones that are just plates of silicone?
They're just like silicone shapes for the brushes.
Yeah, I love those too. That's really good for impasto.
Yeah, or like sculpture.
Yep. Or fantastic for sculpture.
Yeah, that's what I used them for.
Yeah.
That's why you don't have any more.
It's okay. So I'm going to definitely need to come back in and give my horse another coat. But, you know, you kind of see this little Arab coming in. The guy
How do we
that
know it's an Arab? Why isn't that a quarter horse?
Well, because the proportions would be different. The forelegs and everything up here, the shoulders would be smaller. And the head wouldn't be dished. And the butt would be bigger. Quarter horses are the Kardashians of the horse world. And I mean that globally. Not to start no nothing with quarter horse people, but.
Gotcha. So they're rear-wheel drive horses.
They're rear-wheel drive horses with a lot of the same stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
They're not Appaloosa crazy, but, you know, they got a moment. Actually, Arabs are the craziest of the horses.
I say, it's like, you look at an Arab wrong and they, like, spook.
Not spook. They just.
They'll get you.
They'll get you.
Sort of like when you're looking at an animal that's almost as smart as you are.
So we had Arabian horses when I was growing up.
Yep.
Yep. And we did long distance trail riding with them, which they're really ideally suited for. And my mom had a horse, Cappy, that used to spook at his own pee. It's just a problem if you're a horse.
river's going to get me.
Yeah. Exactly. Oh, I remember at the Tevis Cup, which is this really famous horse race, there's this swinging bridge. And I don't know why you would put this between Arabs and their goal, because, like, it just makes a lot of noises and does a lot of things that they don't like. Like, they're just not fans of some of the stuff that this does.
A swinging bridge?
Yeah.
I don't know many people who will cross a rope bridge.
Ooh, I barely got across that one in Canada. Remember?
That was, well, that's an epic rope bridge. That was the one that went across the gorge there.
Yeah.
Right there in Vancouver.
Mm-hmm.
North side of Vancouver.
So much beauty in the Vancouver area. So I'm just painting in sort of a body shape here on my silhouette guy. And again, traceable. Because you don't want drawing to be the reason why you do or don't do a painting. Drawing is just a skill. Just a little skill. I'm just putting that in. I'm not putting in the mane yet or anything because I'm still working out defining some of the details and the lines and how I want the lines to be. Making sure I'm happy with that. And I'm going to pull a detail brush out.
Well, I see that there are some other Arab lovers there in with us, especially Andy.
Andy.
Yeah, who just was like, yeah, and this is what you need to know about Arabs.
What does Andy have to say?
It's like Arabs are the oldest breed, generally slender and smaller than quarter horses. They are also gaited horses. They prance and have a bit more elegance when they walk.
That is exactly what they do. They have elegance.
They prance. I think prancing is an accurate description of an Arab.
Yeah, they'll just tell you what it is. And the higher their tail is, the better they're feeling. That's like a little flag of happiness.
Marlene thinks you should paint a Frisian.
I love Frisians.
Bring on the Frisians.
And we are, because remember, Angeloni and I are painting those famous paintings.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm painting La Belle Dame Merci, which is a Frisian.
That's true. Now, you like painting some horses.
I do. I'm comfortable with it.
Boy, Bonnie had an understatement there.
What?
She's like, aren't Arabs a little temperamental? It's like, whoa.
But you know what? They'll protect you. They'll guard you.
They will protect you when they're not being spooked and trying to trample your head.
They're not trying to. They'll definitely try not to step on you. They'll do their best.
They'll do their best to not trample you while they're being spooked.
They are. They're very sensitive about their feet. They'll do their best to not step on you on their way out. If you choose to take on a battle with an ankle-biting dragon, which they can see, if you choose not to listen to them that it's there, that's on you.
They're exiting one way or another.
They're exiting, and they'd happily take you with them if you're willing to go right now.
Yeah.
In a hurry.
But you're a big fan of Arabs.
Yeah, I am a big fan of Arabs. They're tremendous athletes, and they're amazing animals, and that's what we grew up with, and I have nothing but admiration for them, even though my mom's horse was completely crazy.
Yeah.
He was just on another level.
So there was a... So Kim was saying that she worked as a squire in a real Drouse troop up in the Michigan Ren Fair.
Oh, all right. You know something about that.
I do. I was in the SCA when, and they started doing the experimental jousting. And so I had a chance to try my hand.
Experimental is key to that whole statement.
Yeah, it wasn't sanctioned by the governing body, but we were given experimental permission at that time. Actually, a good friend of mine was running that program and gave me a chance to joust. So that was pretty cool. It wasn't we didn't use full wooden lances. We used a 4-foot wooden lance with about 4 foot of a collapsible. Cardboard tube, and then about a 4 foot of foam tipped. So when you got hit, it still was an impact, but it wasn't going to kill you.
Yeah. I'm putting in the basis for his face right here, which is this weird little teardrop. So this is how I get this in, and then I'm going to attach the neck I've got a nice little arced thing for his. Is this? Oh, good. This is on up close. So the trick about this is you can always add to. You can subtract. If you overpaint, you can mix these colors and go back and try to remove it. But it's a pain in your tuchus.
Hmm. Kristen would like to know if you'd consider doing a Kentucky Derby painting.
I would love to do a Kentucky Derby painting.
Would you?
Oh, my racehorses, yeah.
We should do that then. In the Derby, because you know, I saw that the last Derby.
Did you?
Yeah, just like by chance, where they had the new Triple Crown, I think it was.
That is an impressive race.
It was. It was just like out of the blue. I just happened to be watching it. It was like the first time a Triple Crown had been won in like so many years. I was like, wow, that's crazy.
Yeah, it's a big deal. I'm going to do the little nose here, poke that out, and then, I don't know, he gets lips. He's a person. I'm going to maybe give him some hair. That's what I'm doing. He's got some hair. He's looking down and going, what you doing, horse? I'm not getting it. I'm not getting it at all.
You know, if you're going to do the Kentucky Derby, you got to do like the, what do you call it? The horse, the dog show.
Oh, the Westminster?
The Westminster.
These are not even related.
I know, but it's like they're animals.
I mean, I'm totally up for doing it. Well, we have a very famous animal coming up.
Oh, that's right.
That's right. It's a surprise.
Super secret stuff.
Super secret stuff. But there's...
Well, there's awesome stuff coming.
Awesome animal stuff coming. People are going to freak out. All right. So I put in his little arm, and I'm going to get a little hand rendered up here. Now a little shape to that. I'm going to put reins in that, so hopefully that's going to make some sense. It's nice that when you do silhouettes, a lot of times, like, things that are maybe not initially making sense then suddenly make sense, and you just kind of got to hope for that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm liking the dish on the head. But you can clean, again, you can go back with paint and clean any of this up to make yourself happy. I'm really pleased with the dragons I've been seeing lately. It made me feel like
gosh,
I could do this horse.
Really cool dragons coming up. Yeah. I've seen all the dragons that have been coming up on the pages and just love them.
I'd like to add, if you're trying to do the traceables and you're wondering how those work, because we'll put this up on here, is Lindsay's got a DIY transfer paper video, and I'll try to link it into this, and explains how to turn what you print out into a traceable, and then you just do whatever you can print out size. So if you can print out an 8x10, that's the size you're painting. You're just not doing a 16x20. Or you can tile. I'm terrible at tiling. Which is to blow it up to its size and break it up into tiles and then reconstruct it back together like a puzzle. And I may give a horn to the saddle. We'll see. And I'm just trying to deepen the black, especially here on the horse. So hopefully, guys, you guys can see the difference that second coat makes. Now, I'm painting pro paints.
Mm-hmm.
So if you were painting a student paint, it could be really challenging to get your black and just be okay with that. If it takes a couple coats, that's what it takes.
Yeah, just throw down a couple paint, couple coats.
You know, coming around the knee here.
It's just a little extra art therapy.
Just a little extra art therapy. Silhouettes will really chill you out. That's one of the reasons why they're a lot of fun and a little less fiddly than a Zentangle.
Yeah.
Which can be a little bit like, at some point, be like, oh, this is starting to aggravate me. The silhouette, you're just painting it in. You're just building it up. So just very carefully deepening the silhouette. Defining the shape. Cleaning the line. I'll come in and have fun with the mane and tail in a second.
Okay.
Yes? There's
sure,
a question.
Yeah.
I feel a question brewing with you.
No.
I'm going to switch to an even smaller, sharper bright.
There may be some mocking coming.
Why is there mocking?
I don't know.
Is there something wrong?
No.
Is it like the lighthouse all
I'm
over
I'm just
again?
Feeling punchy today. We're just going to...
I'm loving them lately, though. Like, on Facebook and everything has been cracking me up. So we're going to come down the flank, and then we're going to give this horse a nice little tail. And like we mentioned earlier... Happy Arabs. They either do the flag or the flick. This one's doing a flick. I thought it'd be fun to have a little flick going on. So I just carve this up. And how I get the tapered edge is I lighten my brush pressure. Practice your thick and thin lines. When you're at home, before you do something you're like that needs a really refined line out of you, practice it on scratch paper. Make sure you can get it and then apply it to your canvas. Sure, you can erase everything. You absolutely can, but it's work.
Yes.
Now, so nice. This part of the tail will probably often be bare, so you're definitely going to want to start the little hairs. Just about a quarter of an inch. It's a weird thing. I may have that tail a little bit high. Feeling like I do now. But we're going to deal with it. Versus a really high tail. It's just how that worked out for him. Arabs also tend to have shorter spines.
Mm-hmm.
That not being relative to what happened there. Just observationally, I might have dropped it down just a smidge, just a scotch. But it's not going to affect our overall results, so we're not going to worry about it too much. So I'm just painting this nice little tail. Isn't that fun?
Yeah.
Are we liking our little horse?
I'm digging it.
Are you digging it? Hopefully you'll dig it.
I think everybody out there is digging it, too. They're all talking about how awesome the various types of horses are.
Yeah. Everybody's favorite horse. I wonder what it is. Everybody's favorite horse. You got to wonder what it is. All right. Now I'm going to do some main work here.
And we have good news that Eileen's son is doing good from his motorcycle accident.
That is really good news. I'm going to come here and do the forelock, and we're going to all send Eileen and her son just happy, light, and love. Because that's very good. I'm flicking some little hair up there because he's tossed his head. And some of this mane is going to come up. Sorry, guys. I really want to show the reins going to the hands, so I'm not going to take all the mane. Just some of it, because I just wanted some, to be flying up.
He's got some horse 80s hair.
It's flinging. He's got some hairband moments going on here for sure.
So I think somebody said it earlier, said that horse is really flicking.
Yes. It's definitely going on.
It's Kristen. Kristen said that horse, he's really flicking.
He is.
That does just seem to describe what that horse is doing.
Yeah, he's having a little moment. And I'm going to catch this hair and blend it in right there. Keeping the neck true and letting the mane do its thing. Now I'm going to come back and smooth this brush stroke. Because believe it or not, the directionality of that brush stroke can mess with your eye a little bit. So go ahead and smooth back the neckline. Weird little thing you might not know on a silhouette painting. But when you're, like, you won't necessarily see it on the camera. But when you're up close and personal, it will bug you. I'm going to pull some nice paint on my brush. And I'm going to.
Somebody says it. Bonnie was saying that someone in there had said that it looks like he's checking his cell phone.
Okay, well, sorry.
It's just kind of funny. There you go. Give him a little more reins there.
No, yeah. That's down a little bit.
He's checking his iPad while the horse is freaking out.
So here's what's actually interesting about this and tends to be realistic. A lot of times you'll duck your head when your horse rears up because they also like to throw their head back into your head.
So he's
You don't always do that nice cowboy, like, lean back, arm out. Though I thought about doing that. But, you know, this is the painting we put up on the time lapse. I'm going to give the saddle horn.
No texting while driving.
He's not writing English, and now we know that's true. And I'm going to give underneath here a couple little straps for the tack and equipment we're not seeing.
Uh-huh.
And you just keep cleaning that up until you're super, uber happy with it. Now I'm going to get my angle brush. My half-inch angle. Get a little water in here. Load it up. And I'm going to make some bushes.
Bushes.
Bushes. And I'm just going to tell some bush story here. I'm going to go up and down, sort of like the Jackie Chan of the clouds. I'm going to try not to clone. Because what I'm saying is there's this bush here.
If you Boy, keep pushing the wrong button as you go over there. Can you adjust the close-up camera for me?
Yeah. Bushes. And when you clean off, we're going to show you how to clean off the chalk when it's all done. Because I don't need chalk in the tree and this will be dry enough. Now I'm going to come along here. Little bushes. Bushes. It does help to say bushes.
Bushes.
Bushes. Totally helps. Chicken chong your bushes is very, very helpful. Serious art business here.
What did you call it?
Totally do it. Bush art business.
Oh.
Serious. Bushes.
Bushes.
Now, you can also turn your angle brush around so the long bristles are down and the short ones are facing up.
What are you doing?
Turning my angle brush around.
You go down. Okay.
That direction. Oh, that's really cool. Yes.
I'm going to look over on this camera because I can actually see your hand doing the brushstroke.
And we're just saying there's some stuff. Landscape. Far off in the distance, John.
Far?
Far away in the distance.
How do you know they're far?
Well, because it's small. You're using size relationships. This is big. This is close. This is farther away. Because it's small. I'm just coming up and down. I'm just telling some bush stories. And we'll come back once the tree is in and make even more little detailed bush stories, like of trees that are living far, far away. You just tell those little bush stories. Fun stuff to tell a bush story.
Okay.
You're like, I believe you, but this is a happy, easy painting to do.
Just putting some in there.
We're just putting them in there. We're enjoying them. Right? Now, you could have put a whole different cowboy in here. If you want a different cowboy expression, you could orient the cowboy in differently. You could just do it. This is just the process. Sunset, silhouette. It's the
could
process.
Be cowgirl.
Right. Like, he's dry here. When he's is he dry? Yeah, he's dry. So I could, like, brush off this extra chalk.
I can't see it on the close-up. You'll have to.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, there it goes.
So he's dry. So just brush off this extra chalk. This works if he's dry. This works terribly if he's wet.
Ah.
If he's dry. And if it's making him chalky, just add a little moisture to your brush. Gotta watch this down here. It might be wet. See? Now he's just a nice silhouette. Just a nice, happy silhouette. Of a guy checking his cell phone, having his little cell phone moment.
Horse is all, you know, I saw a plastic bag. And he's like, dude, my horse is freaking out. Let me text my friend.
Well, the guy who took this photo originally, that we took it from Paint My Photo, he breeds Arabians.
Hmm.
Yeah, so, his ranch. So these are his photos that that we are inspired by today. We're inspired by these photos today. I'm painting your pole.
That's all right.
All right. So I'm going to tell a little tree story here. I'm going to plant my seed right here in the lower right. I've got a bright that's loaded like this. See the load?
Yep.
I'm going to paint on the edge of the bristle.
You going to get close up on that?
Is it not on that? Thank you. And I'm going to come up and tell a little tree story.
Tell a little tree.
All right, he's going to grow here. Maybe he's going to bend over this way because this is mesquite. He might even go off the canvas. What do you think of that? That way.
You broke it.
Did I break it?
You broke the canvas. You went off it.
I broke it.
The canvas is broken.
I'm going to come over a couple inches to the right further. and I'm going to make this sort of parallel line. And the line then is going to start to intersect, to converge on the tree. And it's going to get skinnier and skinnier as it exits.
Excellent.
That's what I'm trying to make it, skinnier and skinnier off the trunk.
And I'm with Eileen. I really love that sky. I think it turned out really cool.
Is it? We're happy with the sky. And you could do this with, you could put a duck here. Any silhouette will work on this sky, by the way. I mean, I'm going to show you a few more, but. Because I just, every once in a while, like to just do a silhouette painting. They are fun. Once you have the sky down, then you can be like, silhouette elephant. There's probably a landscape all in silhouette with an elephant painted on this sky. People would be like, ooh. And then there's another kind of sunset sky I'm going to have to show you guys later that's blues and golds and pinks that you see less commonly that I also think is nice. We're going to have a lot of these. We've got the simple birds at sunset, which is the simple, simple sunset.
Are there any more complicated ones coming up?
Yeah. Right.
There are. Some
well,
big hoots.
Like, so we've got next, we've got the Bob one isn't complicated except that we're translating an oil painting into acrylic.
Right.
You know,
that's,
and,
you know.
And then there's going to be I've got a lone bird flying in front of a sun. It's actually pretty involved. But it's the secret one that's going to be uber complicated. It's going to be like about where the dragon was. Mentally, maybe more. How do we like that? Does that seem all
that's
bent?
That's looking pretty good. So the secret painting that we have coming up that we can't tell you about, that's super awesome, but has to do with animals that we can't tell you about, is going to blow your mind. And it's difficult.
It is going to blow your mind, and it will be mentally and emotionally difficult.
But it will be cool. I know it will teach you some awesome skills. I'm looking forward to, like, watching it, just seeing what you're going to do with it.
Yeah, it's going to be bananas. I'm going to switch to my sharp Filbert because of its sharpness. Filbert is a rounded brush. This is a small one.
It's a small one or it's a small 12?
No, it's a small number 6, but it wouldn't matter for in no other brush. This it won't be 6, so you'd have to get a creative mark, Ebony Splendor, to get the exact same size.
You know, but I have to say that a lot of our Sherpettes like to get exactly what you're using, so it's good to tell.
Yeah,
tell
and we need to make a kit of that.
Well, here in the not too distant.
It is so hard to shop online.
I think that Bob's going to help us hook up the Amazon stuff so that...
Bob is my cousin, y'all.
Yeah. Bob, her cousin, is going to help us make sure that we've got all of our Amazon integration working so that you guys can just click and buy from the links below. In the
That's what his
future.
Company specializes in, isn't it?
They do a lot of things in the cryptocurrency and merchanting world. Being able to help us with affiliate networks is just one small thing that they can help with.
So I'm just telling a little twiggly story down here. Remember that your branches need to get skinnier, skinnier as they go out. Now, I feel like up here, I need another little branch that just takes a little journey off some other direction that way. Mesquites are kind of whack job little plants on a good day.
Mm-hmm.
They're very burly. You know, so it's just important to realize that and be brave with your tree. I'm just making that
tree. Be tree brave.
Be tree brave.
There's some fear for trees out there.
Is there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fear tree. Don't fear the trees.
Don't fear the trees.
It's just a tree.
Just a happy little bent up tree out in the country.
As long as they're smaller at the top and bigger at the bottom, it's okay.
Yeah. Don't take on those trees that don't do that. Those weird Indian or African trees that grow like...
Those are the trees I'm good at. They're like the boboa tree.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the one that I make. Where it's like a stump at the top and a twig at the bottom. That's mine.
That is your specialty.
Yep. I make those trees.
Now, if you're really, really worried, like I'm very confident in freehanding this out. I wander around on this tree. See me wander?
You wandered...
I'm going to get up here and see the wander.
I wandered.
Wonder, 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 wonder. Only works when Honey's here. Because she actually makes it cool. Because that child is musical. I like her mommy. So I'm just meandering up here with this twiggly little branch. Oh, wait. No, you've got a little friend growing off. You rebel.
Rebels.
You rebels. Fun stuff. This has a little branch that's doing some craziness. Crosses over. Are we seeing everything? You gotta let me know when I need to move up. Close cam.
I'm kind of giving them angles, different sides, so they can see your.
It's just wonderful and fun. I pick a little branch and I'm gonna just grow it out this way.
So Dusty was asking about brushes, and she was saying, you know, how about low end and high end brushes, and you know, where to get the best deal on brushes.
Yeah.
You know, let's say at Michael's all the way up to the Satin brushes.
Yeah.
You just go get them on sale.
I just get them on sale. So Jerry's has these sales twice a year. Dick Blick has these sales, and then they like just put stuff like on 75% off list.
Yeah, Jerry's has been really good to us over the years.
Yeah. Jerry's has been amazing to us. We have a Jerry's here in Houston. Jerry's are from Houston.
Mm-hmm.
It's run by a guy named Daniel. We really like Daniel.
Yeah, Daniel's a great guy. And George was the old manager. And he's now got a store up in San Antonio. That's right, yeah.
So if you're in San Antonio, you can go see one of Mom's best friends, George.
Yeah.
Jerry George, that's what we call him. Jerry George.
Go see George at Jerry's Artorama in Austin, or Daniel here in Houston.
But you got to call him Jerry George. No, you don't.
You don't have to call him Jerry George. But
he really is. Have too many Georges in our life, and so Mom and I started doing that just to be like, which George are you talking about?
But, I mean, he really does live and breathe Jerry's.
Yeah, he does.
He helped out so many artists just, you know, trying to give him a hand up at that store, so...
Daniel, too, man.
Daniel does all the time. He's always donating stuff to the charities and helping artists come in there. So it's been wonderful working with both of them.
Yeah, they're both awesome. So I'm just making all these weird little branch stories. See that crazy little branch? I like that little weird branch.
Everybody branch likes your weird happy. Branches.
That's making me happy. I like getting crazy on the branches. This is the part that drops your blood pressure. The reason I'm enjoying this, are you watching the time for picking up spider?
You have 55 minutes.
Oh, I'm so zen. I'm good. Because we're nearly at the end of this. Just breaking up some branches. It's so fun to do these. I'm going to make a little teeny tiny twig. Sneak it up over here. I don't know why I'm whispering. Don't turn up your computer. It'll be fine. It's a little twig here. A little bit off there. It's fun to do. Fun to do. This little lump here feels like it needs a little branch, didn't it?
Well, you just disappeared there for a minute.
I'm sorry. Sometimes you'll see a hole. In Quest, we'll talk about this a lot, about trusting that inner voice. You'll be looking at something like, that has a hole. Fill the holes. Trust yourself.
So you can do maybe a cactus there instead of a tree?
You can totally, you can silhouette anything.
You could.
Totally, all cactus. You do have a coyote howling. I just like the horse. I mean, it's your silhouette. Once you do the sunset sky, you may silhouette what you like.
Mm-hmm.
You know that idea, it's your world. Literally is your world. I'm guiding you through some steps in this world, but you could like completely go off the reservation, paint what you like, do what you like, tell your story how you please. I am pleasing myself with these little branches.
Yes, you're just branching out.
I'm just branching out. Now it's fun for me. I like to do this thing here. Let's see if I've got the up-close cam on it. I like to pretend that there's a couple little leaves that are still stuck here and there. Isn't that fun, John?
Yeah.
Just a few. Not like a lot. Just a few. like that. Just on the tree.
Just a little couple there.
Just, yeah, that just hung out. Now I'm going to rinse. Rinse my brush and probably sacrifice my drinking water. And I'm going to come right here, I think.
So
I take a small amount of yellow because we're almost done. And I'm going to make a really almost yellow, like it's the white with just a little yellow. Just
so
a little.
There's a very confusing set of questions that were going on in channel. That's why I was a little distracted. They're like, so when is the secret painting, John? I was like, I thought this was the secret painting, guys. And they're like, no, the one you can't tell us about. And I was like, oh, you mean the super secret painting, the one
this
that we can't tell you.
This is the surprise painting. See, right. I did a little sun right there.
Oh, that's it.
It's fun. A little sun.
Dot.
You painted the sunset silhouette.
Huh.
But you guys have asked. Oh, you know what? I forgot the second rain.
What'd you forget?
There's but one rain.
Dude, he dropped his other rain.
Well, it's just apparently not there at all. There you go. I just need to, or it'll bug me. It'll bug me a lot.
It bugged you.
Do you love it? I love it.
I get you back over there. There you are. I can see you.
Is this fantastic? Hopefully you really liked it. You gonna run and see if that's true?
I will in a minute. We're okay.
Okay. So here it is. It's a gorgeous sunset. I'm going to get a picture of it. I'm going to send it over to Chuck. I'm going to get the traceable. Everything's always in the description below.